Hey everyone, Dr. Pedram Shojai here with Dr. Sarah Gottfried at the Health Bridge. Hi, Sarah.
Hi, Pedram. Hello, everyone.
Hey, so we have a special guest today, and we're going to talk about something that's really important. We got David Bronner of Dr. Bronner's Magic Soaps. You guys have seen this stuff, I promise. If you've gone into any of the health food stores, this is the soap that's everywhere. I've used it for years. And David, welcome to the show.
Yeah, well, thanks for having me.
Yeah, so your grandfather started, was Dr. Bronner, huh?
Yeah, so he himself was a third generation soap maker from a German Jewish soap making family, Southern Germany. He was trained in the guild system of the time, an apprentice to a master soap maker, and got the equivalent of a master's in chemistry. Had a lot of generational conflicts with his parents, and his dad and uncles were running the show. And he was Zionist, pretty political, pretty hardcore and intense, pretty much day one. And just repeated clashes. His parents were kind of more like, the madness is going to blow over, you know, settle down. And so one thing led to another, he came over in the late 20s and worked as a consultant for the U.S. soap industry. Then out of the, he was unable to get his parents out. He's got his two younger sisters out, but was unable to convince his parents to leave. And they were gassed in the early 40s, and the Nazis nationalized the factory. And kind of out of the trauma of this, of the Holocaust, and as well as like some personal tragedy with his wife dying when my dad was very young, just he was also just always a very mystical guy, and just really saw very intensely and immediately that if we don't realize our transcendent unity across ethnic and religious divides, we're going to perish and kill ourselves in a world of nuclear weapons. So he felt called on this mission to basically spread this moral ABC. And at the same time, the society, especially in the post-war era, was moving to better living through chemistry. And across the board, industries were moving to petrochemical feedstocks, including in personal care and detergents and body washes and shampoos. And my granddad's family recipe, these natural ecological soaps he brought with them, were kind of out of vogue. And so he was selling these soaps on the side as he would go around the country lecturing and spreading his peace plan, and realized that people were coming more to buy the soap after he's done talking than necessarily to hear all the way through. And this is when he put all his philosophy on the labels, which, you know, just has become like kind of our iconic brand. But the soap was always more to sell a label than vice versa. He blew up in the 60s, but he always ran the company as a nonprofit religious organization and gave all his profits to the causes he believed in. And we continue that to our day. And even though the IRS disagreed with the tax-exempt religious status and he was in bankruptcy in the late 80s, and we're now a for-profit, we still cap all salaries and compensation and give all our profits to the causes we believe in. All our supply chains are certified organic and fair trade. I think it's very important to take care of your own backyard and make sure that your materials are produced in a sustainable way, both environmentally and socially. And then using our profits. Yeah.
Wow.
And David, I love this. I mean, what an amazing introduction to this experience in your family. I use Doc Bronner soaps going back to Alaska and like being camping and taking them with me. I want to get to this cause that, yep. You know, it sounds like your family, you have it in your genes to really support a cause. And there's a particular cause in Oregon that I think is important to highlight today. Tell us about that.
Yeah. So I would say about 3 years ago, I mean, we're all about fair trade, sustainable agriculture and psychedelic reform and supporting youth programs. And genetic engineering of foods was not high on my priority list. I mean, it's like, oh, this is a problem that the chemical industry is bought the seed industry, but hey, if they're actually boosting yields or, you know, using this technology in a way that's actually doing something good or reducing pesticide inputs, then, you know, I'm not going to get that upset about it. But in the last 5 years, it became increasingly clear that the only application of this technology that these chemical companies are doing is engineering resistance to their pesticides so that they can sell more pesticide, and or they're actually producing an insecticidal protein inside the plant itself. In both cases, in the case of the insecticidal protein, you're actually expressing insecticide in every single cell, every single plant over the entire growing season. So this is the opposite of integrated pest management that organic farmers use, where you use chemical controls and they have a very restricted toolkit you only use that judiciously, just as needed, and you use cover cropping and you plant perimeter pests, perimeter plants that pests prefer, and you divert pest pressure. And there's other non-chemical ways to take care of pests. But what the chemical industry has done is just said, oh, you just buy these genetically engineered seeds, and you don't need to do anything else except blast chemicals. Just walk away from your farm. You just blast chemicals. So every weed and pest scientist not on the chemical industry payroll predicted, well, you're going to create rapid resistance in the pest populations, just like happens with the CAFOs and factory farms and the overdosing of antibiotics, which has now created these virulent super germs that aren't being killed by any of our standard antibiotic chemistries. So the same thing has now happened. And actually today, just right now, EPA approved 2,4-D crops. So the original herbicide tolerant crop was glyphosate. Glyphosate has been sold as this relatively benign, non-toxic herbicide, and that's kind of BS, but at least that was, they said we don't have to use 2,4-D and dicamba, these much more toxic herbicides. 2,4-D is half of Agent Orange. It's really bad news. But now that glyphosate doesn't work in half the country because they've been overblasting and the weeds survive huge doses of glyphosate, they're desperate for their next generation herbicide tolerant crops, which they just railroaded through through the regulatory process. I mean, they bought off both parties with the single objective of getting their people in FDA, USDA, and EPA to do their bidding, and they just did it. And it's just a disaster. It's the out of control chemical industrial agricultural machine on steroids. This is not freeing us from chemicals.
Out of control chemical industrial machine on steroids. There's a quotable. I love this guy. So what is happening in Oregon, and how can we help? Our listeners right now listening to this today, we need to jump in and put our stamp down on this. And this is a fight for all of us. It's a fight for all of our future. And Oregon right now is the battleground, and we have the momentum. What can our listeners do right now to help this?
They should go to OregonRightToKnow.org, sign up, volunteer, donate. The most effective thing people can do is join our phone bank program and talk to our soft supporters, because right now, I'm sure you're witnessing it or you witness in Washington, the opposition is carpet bombing the state with the most sophisticated propaganda machine ever and confusing voters to vote against their own basic interests, that you have a right to know if what you're eating in your food, you have a right to know if your food's been saturated in pesticides, but people are getting confused. So we need to be calling them and, you know, just talking to them, reassuring them, like, no, this is that. And the other thing they're lying to you about is BS. There's a chemical company selling chemicals that don't care about your right to know. They just care about the bottom line. Just reassure people to just, you know, vote your interest, vote your natural inclination. Don't be confused, because that's what they're all about. Secondarily, we need firepower. We just need to get critical mind share for our messengers and messages. And we have some really great ones. We got Michael Hansen from Consumers Union, Dr. Ray Seidler, former EPA senior scientist. That we need to get critical mind share pushing back against their BS, because, you know, it's unfortunately we need to meet people where they're at, and that's the nightly news. So, so donating, volunteering, it's basically what this campaign's about, and it's about people.
I want to kind of talk about how important we are at this juncture. We narrowly lost in California. We narrowly lost in Washington, and we're building up steam. We are going to win one of these. And I know personally that there's people, like a lot of these companies are watching this very closely. And when Oregon or the next one fall, Colorado's the next one coming, but when one of these falls, the industry is going to be like, okay, look, we got to change tactics. We can't keep throwing money at this. This is ridiculous. And the people have spoken. And so the problem with this notion of the people have spoken is that most people are too busy watching the Kardashians or something else that's mind-numbing and not jumping in and saying, hey, Oregon, we're here. We support you. Stop letting these guys distract you into voting against your best interest. And so it's really important, guys, if you're listening to this right now, what's the website again?
OregonRightToKnow.org.
Awesome. Can we call our representatives? Can we call our senators? Aside from funding, and, you know, I funded this personally, well.org supports this, $35, whatever you can afford will help battle these guys on the airwaves, and it'll help us push this over, because this is, I mean, this is happening right now, this week. This is the most critical time in this. So if you guys are listening to this saying, oh, I should do that, that sounds like a good idea, you will forget. What can people do right now? Go to the website, and what else can they do to help support this?
Yeah, volunteer, donate, just, you know, sign up for the phone bank program. Again, it's like people talking to people is our most effective strategy. You know, nothing substitutes for a real person having a real conversation. And that's what we have, and they don't. You know, we have an army of people, and you know, they just got a bunch of money. So, and then to your point, yeah, if we get Oregon, it's over. I mean, we just won Vermont in May. Jackson County voted to ban these crops, which is a much heavier lift, and they trounced them 2-1. There's like huge farmer power in Oregon right now. The family farmers are on fire. It's really a perfect battleground for us. And if Oregon goes, it's, you know, New York's going to go. We're going to remove triggers from Connecticut, Vermont. Well, Vermont already went. Remove the trigger from Connecticut, win in New York. That flushes the Second Circuit, where right now we're battling them in court. And, you know, these courts are political animals. And if we put enough cultural pressure on them and make the cultural, you know, zeitgeist and consensus, you know, inevitable, then they'll fall in line. And if, you know, if we lose, then it's not so great. Although eventually we're going to win, because, you know, that's how all progressive issues go. And, you know, California was a close loss, hard-fought close loss, bad campaign and a great electorate. Washington, a much better campaign, but the electorate stunk. It was, you know, 2013, really small, old conservative electorate. In Oregon, we have, you know, marijuana on the ballot. We're coordinating closely with the marijuana campaign on the get out the vote efforts and a lot of the grassroots field game. So it's really an ideal electorate and an environment for us to be punching through. So
this is such good stuff. I mean, everybody, you have a right to know what's in your food. This is a measure about labeling and knowing that your foods are exposed to genetically modified organisms. I think this is such an important piece to support. For those of our listeners who live in Oregon, we want you to get out the vote. Learn about this. I have a lot of family and friends in Oregon, and I want you to post this on Facebook. It's OregonRightToKnow.org. So please help support this so that we can turn the tide on GMOs. This is not about, you know, debating the science of how genetically modified food affects your health, even though I feel like there's so much evidence supporting the damage that genetically modified foods do to your body. This is about your right to know labeling. So one more time, OregonRightToKnow.org. Thank you so much, David Bronner, for being with us today and informing us about this important ballot measure.
Yeah, well, thank you for having me, and good luck.
Yeah, hey, thanks for fighting that good fight, too. I mean, you're carrying on your grandfather's legacy, and I honor that. You know, it takes a lot to do the right thing. And in a world where it's very distracting and it's very easy to be selfish, and you guys are doing it. So thanks very much for that. I hope that in a week from now we could be celebrating something, and we'll be in touch with you. And guys, as soon as you're done with this, go to the website. Do it now. Please don't wait. This is happening right now, and we need you to jump in. All right, guys, this has been the Health Bridge. We'll see you next time. Thanks very much, David Bronner.
Yeah, thank you for having me.